one of the last design criteria of the passive house standard is to now put in high performance heating and cooling systems. So the idea is as we improve the building enclosure to a very high level, we pay attention to air tightness, we use windows with favorable solar heat gain coefficients, and we have some internal gains in the building. Now what we have to do is just, in order to maintain comfort, is whatever's left over in terms of our energy load, then we can maintain that with our mechanical system. So we're putting in very appropriate, very small mechanical heating and cooling systems. On this project, we're actually using a VRF system. So this is a variable refrigerant flow system. So we're using an air conditioning system that's going to operate in reverse and become a heat pump during the wintertime and become an air conditioning unit during the summertime. And the idea about with this is that we were able to now deliver whatever precision we need in terms of getting the fluid to the head units in order for us to maintain interior comfort. So we actually can vary the rate of the refrigerant flow up or down depending on the load for that day. We actually chose to go with a ductless option. It's actually more efficient than a ducted option because you don't have a lot of the associated fan energy with the ducted units and all the pressure drops associated with all the duct work. So we're able to directly actually have the air enter into the actual apartment with a higher level of precision. So it gives us a little bit more of efficiency. The units are located in the living spaces. So we have a ductless unit in the living room as well as one in the bedroom. And then as they condition that space and the ventilation system is operating, we're going to get that good flow of air through the building and we're going to have comfortable and stable temperatures throughout the entire apartment. These units are located up on the roof. Again, this building is in an area that's flood prone, but one of the other benefits of going with a refrigerant-based system is that you can move everything up to the roof. And by putting it up on the roof, now you have more resiliency in terms of any natural disasters that take place. It's easier to service and to maintain. So having all the mechanical systems up on the roofs has its advantages. But they have to be secured back down to the structure. So again, we have to maintain our structural integrity, but we also have to minimize our thermal bridging. So these units are on a steel dunnage that's actually thermally broken. It's a little hard to see from this photo, but underneath this steel dunnage, there's actually 100 PSI extruded polystyrene insulation, and that's used to thermally break the dunnage from the concrete roof. So this way now we're going to have a high level of thermal performance. The insulation is going to come up over top of the sort of the flange down here at the bottom of the dunnage, and that's going to have give us our high level of insulation value and maintain the insulation continuity across the roof area. This project, there's not a lot of load diversity in the building, so we didn't incorporate heat recovery. Some of these VRF products are able to actually recover heat energy inside the building, and if we had maybe a more diverse building where we had the need for simultaneous heating and cooling, we could take advantage of that, but for this project it's pretty consistent throughout the entire building. So we're going to have either be in heating only or we're going to be in cooling only throughout the years. And so the last thing is, you know, the one of the biggest loads in the building now becomes domestic hot water. The one thing that passive house doesn't really impact is the domestic hot water consumption. We're looking at thermal energy in the enclosure, we're making sure we're maintaining comfortable surface temperatures and indoor environmental quality, but people, you know, still we're still left with the habits of folks as they live and use the building. So as they consume water, we're going to have to provide that hot water to the building as it's needed. So we're trying to do that in the most efficient and economical way possible. So we're actually using gas-fired condensing boilers. So we have two Lars Neotherm condensing boilers that are 96% thermal efficient. So we have a very high level of efficiency for these systems, and we're using a lot of storage. So we're actually producing the domestic hot water. It's going into 500-gallon storage tanks that are well insulated, and we're going to have that hot water on demand ready to go for the building as the storage tanks hold all that hot water that's needed. The piping runs are very short. We're trying to minimize the piping between the domestic hot water heaters and the storage tanks. And we're, you know, having this up on the roof also adds to that resiliency aspect by making sure that any of the mechanicals that are vulnerable are up on the roof and they're out of harm's way. And then also by maintaining air tightness, these are direct vent appliances, so they don't need to have combustion air coming in through a louver. We can actually provide combustion air directly through a duct to the unit and then exhaust the air through another duct straight to the outside. So again, in terms of maintaining air barrier continuity and overall performance, it works very, very well.